this character, which I assume is the mother of the group. I'm just going to put her in like this. She was wrapped up very warm in a big parka. She was folding round herself, which I liked. And a woolly hood. Say it was a winter night and it was very strong, so I'm not going to be shy at putting the darker tones in here, not shy at all. She had the ubiquitous leggings, black leggings, very large boots. I don't think they were Uck boots. In a way, I think they should have been, but I don't think they were. Perhaps I'll put them. Now, what I liked about this group, this particular group, was that the husband was extraordinarily skinny. His wife, however, was not. And he seemed to be very much in the background. So I'm going to draw them. Why I do people with very long necks, I don't actually know. They just seem to turn out like that. Here he is. And he had his collar up, though he didn't have a scarf. Just sitting there. And perhaps a little paunch. Like this. I remember a modest. See there. Rucksack. I'm going to put on him. Okay, I'm going to remember that very harsh light. Say as I build this library up of people, they'll populate the final image. So normally, if it's a good day, I'll just pop them in as I go onto the final painting. But as it was a pretty cold day, I just did a quick drawing, a few loose ideas, a few photographs. I've got the bones of it. Remember he had some trainers on. One of those people buy really expensive trainers but never go to the gym. And he's perhaps a little bit off balance, but I'll sort it out on the final thing. The nuclear family out for a walk on a very chilly February afternoon on the beach. We've all seen them, and in many senses we are all them. But I'm doing for the moment. Okay, now we're doing the final drawing of Clarence Pier, and as you can see I've done a fair bit already, but I'm just gonna just sort of finish it off now. Shut off my pencil. So as you can see, I'm just gonna keep nice and loose. I almost never use a ruler on my work, very occasionally, but almost never. I just like to keep it all nice and loose, to keep a sense of spontaneity about it, really. So you see, I'm just working it in like this, just doing these. Just to note, I'm just at the top here. I've got one of my bits of photo reference, which I'm glancing at occasionally. As I say, it's never going to be a completely accurate representation. These little pitched roofs here, there's definitely going to be six, as there are six on the original, because that would be an architectural feature. But the rest of it I'm going to keep nice and loose. I've got some verticals here. A bit about Clarence Pier. Obviously it's in Portsmouth where I grew up, and it was originally built in 1861, presumably as a pleasure item or some such. And in 1905 it was extended, and all went merrily along, presumably, until 1941, when I don't know whether the Germans meant to bomb it, but bomb it they did on the 1st of June, and it was pretty much wrecked. That said, however, it was reopened again in 1961. And this is why we have this lovely tower here. You see that yellow tower there? Obviously that's a very much a 50s design, but obviously the build in 1961, the design itself was 1950s. And it's actually quite a wonderful thing. And they've managed to keep it. I presume the reason why they kept it was because they didn't have the money to demolish it, as a lot of councils do. And at the top there's this almost like this flying saucer thing. Here it is, like that. With these little bits of signage on at the top. And every time I look at it, it reminds me of a guy at school. He asked his teacher once where he lived, and he said that, you know, that flying saucer at the top of Clarence Pier. He said, yeah. He said, that's where I live. I live inside that. So every time I look at this, it reminds me of my mate's teacher. But there we are. Just like tighten this one in here. As you can see, very loose, again trying to keep that spontaneity. do enjoy about these buildings is that obviously because of everyone went off to Benidorm in the 1960s and 70s, they're all a little bit dilapidated, which I rather like, I have to say. I think there's a charm in these sorts of buildings. I think they're rather beautiful like that. And almost more charming in the winter, because you can see here there's a digger there and a big pile of shingle and these little barriers here to keep vandals out while they're doing all the repairs. And there's something rather nice about it. Just going to finish this off. Glancing back at the photograph up here. Just here as well. Just this is a HB pencil, by the way. You need to know. I often use a HB or a 2B, or whatever's around, depending on what's at reach. Oh, I think that's good to go. Tidying up. Yeah. A bit of drawing. Splendid. Okay, if you remember earlier, these drawings here, this family, and now I'm going to put it on the final painting. And I've just put them down lightly here, and I'm just going to line them in. And I'll keep this here out of sight as reference. Just start working them in. As I say, though the initial drawings were done with shading, this will just be done with simple line work, because the shading is going to be done with paint, basically. But we just need that there, so I'm just again just keeping it nice and loose. There we are. So say this child was sat on some posts that were poking through the shingle. Just had a recent storm. I think they're either not there before, or buried beneath the shingle, or the shingle had exposed them. Either way, sitting on top. A lot of people are a bit intimidated by doing figure drawing, and I know I have my rather own idiosyncratic style, but if you do any drawing or any painting, I recommend practicing figure drawing, even if you have to trace up a photograph at first or whatever you do. Just try and do some, because it really does help. Really does help make a picture. hope so. Interestingly, these boots have got bigger and bigger the more I've drawn this here. There we are. It's nice and simple. So most of this is going to be in paint later. Just and the dead. Sharpen my pencil quickly. In his pockets. It's nice and loose. Okay, what would normally happen now is I just crack on and start painting. But what I'm going to do in this case is take a slightly longer route and hopefully a slightly easier route. What I'm doing now is putting on the tonal values. You can see, let me just twist here. You can see I've sort of done that here already. The reason why I do that is one of the issues that people have with watercolour, I find anyway, is that it's just too weak. It's more colour than water. So one way around that is to, let's say in a mixture of colours, or in this case Indian ink, or a wash of Indian ink, is to put the tonal values on first and then work over the top. It's amazing, once it's fully dry, it won't go muddy or mix up or anything like that. So here we go. So what I'm doing, I'm taking note of where the sun was, which is to my left here. And I'm just working in these tonal values. I'm using, if you look at this brush here, this is called a rigger, presumably designed for doing rigging on ships. One of the great things about it is you can get quite fine effects with it, and yet at the same time it holds loads of paint, so you can go for ages. It takes a while to use. It's not easy to use because it's so long. I know sign writers use them quite often. It's not easy to use at all. However, it's one of those things that's, for me, worth it. Just putting these tonal values in, and just getting out of the way of the camera now, just steadying my hand and just working stuff in like this. I'm going to put these windows in, just block them in like that. Very simple, keeping it nice and loose as always. See, I'm keeping it nice and loose. make sure as well, I mean, this is universal with watercolour, that your brush is kept really loaded up. Otherwise, it'll dry, and you'll start to scrape the paint on rather than pull the paint on. If you scrape the paint on, it does actually look dry in a funny sort of way. What I'm going to do on this here, obviously there's a shadow under here. I'm going to put that on later. By that I mean the cast shadow of this. There's another shadow that's going to go right across here later. But I can only put that on when this bit is dry. Otherwise it will just merge in together. It's got to look like a cast shadow. We'll see that cast shadow on the painting later on. Okay, nice and loose. I'm just going to drop some. Sometimes you can think you've overdone it. You rarely have. You notice here, I've not gone on to this bit, because this bit is a barrier, one of those mesh barriers. I'm going to do that much lighter in a minute. What I'm going to do now is drop some ink in there, clean the brush, and drop some water in. It's going to start to bloom in a minute. And as I mentioned a minute ago, this is going to be much lighter in here. Now what I'm doing is I'm creating the effect of looking through security mesh. You see, put some here, just drop it in. And this building at the back, there's a window there. And here, at the back there, these windows, you can see I can create it almost like a blade on the brush. And it's very easy just to push them in like that, shift it on its side. And off again, run it across the top. And there we are, just going in, again, keeping it nice and loose. Lastly, these are cylinders. I don't know what's in them. These are cylinders sitting on the beach for the moment. What I'm going to do is I'm just put some water on them first. There. Just put a little bit on. And then I'm going to run some paint down the edges. A bit more water. The idea of the light coming around. Just pull a bit out. Just pull a bit out. And there. And you can tinker a little bit, so long as you don't scrape the brush down and bring up the fibres of the paper. You can go quite a way on this. And remember that mesh. Just, there we are. So we can see that there. Remember that cast shadow at the top there? I reckon that's dry now. So I'm going to run another load like that. There he goes. You can see the effect of the sun. I'm going to run another in like that. And that's how that works. Right, now we're going to put the tonal values on these characters here, just to really remind you. This is my initial drawing. There we are. And we're going to sort of mirror that. That's just out of sight now. A slightly different way of doing this. It's about adding colour, adding tone as we go, really. What we're going to do first is add some light tones here. This is quite loose. Brush slightly and lift a bit off. So it's quite loose in there. And then it's a case of sort of messing about, really. What I'm doing is adding the darker tones. It all looks strange at first. That's a mixture of water, clear water. And paint. Or ink in this case. Just there. These are the posts that were sticking out of the shingle. See that? And it from there. Darker colour. Run that in there on the side. Accentuate that shadow. Start dropping some more in here. Some clear water now. Say I'm pushing it back and forward, and again, if you keep the paper wet, you don't dig in, you can get away with quite a bit. This character here, you might be able to hear my assistant cat Poppy meowing in the background. There's nothing I can do about that. She has her ways. So again, here we are. This is all quite loose watercolour here. I'm just dropping it in into the darker areas. Some water, just take a bit out. Again, just looking for tonal values here. Run some down there. Thank you. you mean? All black. With a pencil just along the knee a bit. Works very well when the water's wet still. For a moment. Speller here. Slightly thicker paint or ink, I should keep saying, reminding myself. Water up here. More or less it. Might take a bit more tinkering, but you get the idea. Once that's dry, which I won't bother doing, I'll put the ground shadows in. I won't put them in now because they might bleed into the characters a little bit, which I don't want. Let's see what's going on. There we are. On this section we're going to start working in some colour over top of those tones. I can see around here I've done a little bit already, so we're just going to work on this bit now. Again, I'm going to use my, shall I show you the paint blocks here, there we go, a bit of a mess but it works itself out in the end. Again, I'm going to use my rigger and getting those nooks and crannies nice and tight. And again, as well as my watercolour I had, I've got my the photo reference at the top here just in case. Say nice and simple. So the blue sections, as you notice, there's plenty of pigment on the brush, which is what we want. We don't want the brush drying out and scraping away at the paper, because the fibres of the paper will then lift and it will all start to go muddy. So these are nice pools of paint, and once this paint's dry, contrary to popular belief, it's quite easy to go over it all again and then put another layer on. It has to be absolutely dry. I often do this, put a layer on like this, and then to give a bit of body, I might take, say, a number six or something, and a very light yellow, and just wash it scruffily over the top. It gives it a sort of texture, because again, we don't want it to look too neat, too mechanical. It's got a bit of sort of vitality to it. I'm leaving these spaces here because it looks to me like there's advertising spaces in those gaps. I'm going to put them in. So there we are. See, they're going in. And that blue is really picking up nicely. I think it's called Berlin blue. I'm one of those painters that never seems to remember what colours they've used. They just prod around the paint until something starts to work, and I use that. One thing I'm not that keen on in its raw state is ultramarine blue, because it can look a bit gritty for some reason. So I mix it up with a few other blues to knock it back a bit. And these cylinders I did earlier, and they're behind a little fence here, so this bit I'm going to do lighter, just so we know we've picked up behind a fence, like this. And this is all drying here, so I'm going to leave that and move on to somewhere else. Just clean the palette off here, and up here. The tower itself is a very bright yellow. So I'm going to use Windsor yellow and a cadmium yellow together. Now, this I think, if you have a look in here, this thing here, I think this is going to need more than one coat because it really is vivid. I'll have a look at it. And so, as I say, once I'm doing this, everything else is dry as I'm working on this bit. As you can tell, everything's nice and loose. The paint is pretty fully loaded. Not too neat, but not overworked, so it starts to pull up the paper and dry reasonably flat. And also, you can see, no you can't, also there's this more orange digger that's sitting on the pile of sand there, a stronger colour. So I'm just going to work that in. Work it in lines, basically. You can see this white space around it. That sort of, I suppose it sort of imitates a highlight. So that's that in there. As you say, I'm moving in a bit of that blue wall I've forgotten. So I'll put that in now. There we are. In it goes. Nice and quick. As you can tell, the shadows that I put on earlier are starting to work now. Something I've forgotten here as well. There we are. Some more blue in sort of advertising thing going on. Just nip that in. There's some yellow bits, green bits in here. Looks like there's an advertising thing, isn't it? Start marking some shapes and just representing what I can see on these little posters. A little bit in there as well. Going very loose. Also, what I'm going to do is very quickly start sand, or shingle actually, it's a shingle beach. Now what I'm doing, I'm mixing colours from the palette. You can't quite see this from where you are, but I'm just grabbing a bit of yellow, and a bit of green, a bit of this and a bit of that. And once that dries, I can put another coat on it if I want to. And the important thing about that is it's not a flat shape. And I can just pull in some yellow here, drop that in there, doesn't matter if it bleeds. Now underneath, behind the fencing, I can put this in lighter. It's important this needs to be lighter. And once this is in, just put something there like that, I'll probably put a very thin coat of blue over the top, and that indicates it's a sort of fence barrier type thing. You can see that's slightly, I want to differentiate that colour above now, so I'm mixing up some firmer browns so I can whip it in underneath that fence like this. So now I think it probably tells quite well now, like this. There we are, definitely got a difference, definitely see that fence now. What I'm going to do now is mix up a bit of yellow, loads and loads of water in it, just start dropping it in. It'll start to bloom out. Put a little bit in here, just to help it work a bit more. But again, I want to make sure it's different. It's this, making sure that we can tell that that's a fence there. I think we've done it, to be honest. I'm using, put another bit of blue. It's strange that you have blues into shingle, but you do. It's the opposite to yellow, and it'll darken it out without it going flat. Essentially, that is how you paint the painty bits. Enough for now. Okay, I'm just going to paint these characters here. It's much the same as painting everything else, but I thought I'd go through it just for the detail side of things. And the woman first, as I recall, had the ubiquitous Parker. So again, the trusty rigger. Very simple. Just go over there like this. And as you can see, the work that I did previously with the tonal values is starting to bear fruit, because I don't have to worry too much about getting the shading right, really. And this is just a sweep of a wash of green. The only thing I am going to add a little bit of light on the front, is some very loose Windsor yellow. Got to do this at a certain time, just as it's starting to dry. So I'm just going to drop it in here. You see it starting to bloom a little bit, I don't know if you can. And I'm just going to pull a little bit out as I'm drying the brush. Just pulling a little bit out. You see we've got a little bit of flow there. I'm going to run a little bit more green down the back. That essentially is it. Very simple. We've got a roundedness of the character. her husband. Again, jeans. Very simple. And our tonal values we put in earlier on. Again, bearing fruit. That works. I believe his son had jeans on too. What I'm going to do is just whip them, getting a brown together for those posts. Just quickly, again, same routine. One sweep, in they go. Still wet there. I'm going to do a bit of red down the back. Just a little bit. You can see that on the front. Very light wash of Windsor yellow down the front. The brush is still very wet. Don't have to worry about that. Let that do its own thing. Now for a little bit of fun, a smaller rigger to do this guy's sweatshirt. I'm going to show form on it. It's sort of almost like a bit of a Where's Wally thing. But if I do this, it's up to his arm. It's like that. His arm around. This can keep the rigger quite wet, and as we've done his jumper or his sweatshirt, do whatever, a sort of a form there. Sort of working, and leave that white. Risking it here because that red might still be a bit wet. And there's the strap of the backpack. Just in like that. He's done. Starting to work now. Quite simple. Rest of it for dark colour. Shoes, what have you. On the boy there. That little rigger. Should have gone back to the other one really. The other one. There we go. I'm going to leave her leggings because I quite like them like that. I don't need to do anything. Put his hair in. Child. Not sure what to do with her hair yet. Do now is the skin, a bit of vermilion, a bit of yellow, should do ya. It's a bit of a cold day, it's the hand there, a bit of a cold day, so I'm just gonna lift a little bit of vermilion. Cheeks. There we are. That'll dry out okay. She's got sandy brown hair. And a bit of fun. He's got some little stripes on his trainers. Boy's jumper, I think. been vertical and a bit broader. And there we are. Family on the beach. Playing the stage. We're going to do the horrible nightmare that is water. Should be okay. Good luck here. It's going to finish about here, so we don't have to worry about this bit too much. And this is this obviously Clarence Pier, and this is looking over to Gosport. When I was a child, these buildings were made of just concrete. These two buildings, they've since been done up. It looked like a gulag actually, but since it's been done up, it looked like two giant licorice all sorts, and all the better for it really. But nevertheless, we're going to do the water. Again, I'm keeping it as simple as I possibly can. I know it can be a complete nightmare for people. But what I'm going to do is do it using my rigger as usual. And if you have a look here, I've done mixed up two different blues which are out of shot. I'm going to use them alternately as I go. There's plenty of paint here with plenty of water, and the thing is, of course, is to keep moving. But because there's plenty of paint, it can be quite forgiving. I'm going to try and navigate my way around this yacht here and these waves in here. When we get down to here, I'm just going to play it by ear and see what happens really. But here we go. So again, plenty of water, plenty of paint. So I'm going to lean in here. The camera's slightly in the way, but there we are. I'm going to run that along there. Again, I'm just navigating around. Now the paint is mounted up around that yacht. But I'm not going to worry about it because, as I say, the paint is quite wet. So what I'm going to do is start moving it like this. This is an interpretation of waves. You just keep going like this. Start seeing something happening. Wipe that out slightly. I'm going to swap to the next colour paint. And here we go again. Again. Just working it in. Just nudging in underneath that there. Try that out. Just start using this water. Now there's a little bit of a trail beyond that yacht. Pour this water out here. Once we get past the yacht, it'll be a little bit easier. Swapping the paint around. In with the paint now. There we are. To navigate up against these little waves where they break. Using the other colour. Just dipping in. Yes. As you can see, I've run it up against the waves. We sort of need to go vertically now. So I'm just going to try and create some sort of thing going on these waves. Right in there. Swapping the colour. Just keep it a little bit. swap to a smaller rigger. Just finishing off a few things here. Just bringing some. This is almost dry now up here. I think this up here actually is dry. Just running some paint in. Picking out that yacht a little bit more. Okay. Get on the verge of overdoing it. So we just want to do few things. And under each, I'm dressing underneath of each break of a wave, there's a dark bit where the shadow, where the foam of the wave curls over and creates a shadow underneath. So I'm just going to dip that in to here. Takes practice. There we are, and if you have a look at those pier heads, there's going to be some of this going on. And that should be that.